Hi, hello everyone, and welcome to my talk on Kubernetes security. I am Anupam Chomal, and let's get started on my presentation. So first, who am I? I I'm a security architect. I work in the area of product application and network security. Overall, I have around 18 years of work experience in this domain. Network and product security are my main area of interest. I'm in the middle of a transition right now. So you can reach out to me on my personal email address if you have to on this particular previous slide. Just a moment, yes. Right. And I have a master's in information technology from IIT Bombay. So that's about me. So getting started. The agenda for today's presentation is, first I'm going to explain why the topic of Kubernetes security, why did I pick up that topic. I'll give a quick introduction to Kubernetes architecture. This is not an introduction to Kubernetes. However, at places where I'm talking specifically about some Kubernetes module or some Kubernetes architecture specific thing, I'll be explaining it in brief so that even folks who are not aware of Kubernetes in detail are able to understand the concepts. And I'll then talk about the possible attack vectors of Kubernetes and how to defend against them. In the end, I will talk about best practices, and I will summarize in the end about the presentation as a whole. So basically, there's lots to cover and there is less time. There is lots on the internet that talks about Kubernetes security. There are many videos, there are many books available. Then why this particular topic? This topic because I have a vast amount of experience and knowledge in traditional IT and application security. And looking at Kubernetes evolve, I have tried to compare that traditional security with Kubernetes security, or the issues that you find in traditional networks or traditional IT software or IT setup with that in Kubernetes. And I'm trying to draw parallels, and you would see that many of the principles that apply in traditional software security or say network security also applies to Kubernetes security. So that is something that will come out during the presentation, right? A disclaimer. This is completely my opinion. Nobody else is responsible for the opinions that I've presented in this presentation. Much of the information that I've sought and I've got is from the internet, from books and stuff. I don't claim to be the original author of any of the content in this slide. If I have borrowed content from the internet or any other books, I have made sure I give sufficient references for the same. So with the disclaimer out, just an abstract, you can read it, but I'm going to anyways explain this topic as we go ahead, or explain the gist and what I'm trying to cover in the presentation as we go ahead. Another thing, that containers, Docker and Kubernetes are all interlinked. So Docker spawn containers and Kubernetes is used to orchestrate containers. So any of the security aspects that I talk about is generally for containers, Docker, and Kubernetes, across. Again, an assumption that the audience already understands the various components in Kubernetes. As I said earlier, I'll try to give a quick introduction to that particular concept whenever I'm touching. So for example, if I'm touching etcd, it's a database to store secrets, or cluster configuration. So I'm going to explain that in brief whenever that particular thing comes up. But the general assumption is that people are already aware about Kubernetes. This presentation is only about Kubernetes security, not an introduction to Kubernetes. Yes, so moving ahead. As I said, I'll give an introduction to the Kubernetes architecture. Containers are a means of virtualization. And Dockers are used to create these containers, whereas Kubernetes are used to orchestrate the containers. Now, uh, so That having said that, Dockers have images, and Docker container is a runtime instance of that image. Docker container is a standalone package. Basically, one container having everything, the code, the libraries, tools. So all you need is that particular image, and that image, when it runs, it virtualizes that entire environment. Now, Kubernetes is allowing the automation of this container provisioning or scaling out or load balancing and stuff like that. So Kubernetes is very good for orchestration. Kubernetes still needs something to spawn the container. And other than Docker, there are other ways also to spawn that particular container, Docker being one of them. Yes, interesting. Now, why this particular topic? So Kubernetes today is everywhere. It's probably the third most preferred platform for developers to do the development. Now, having said that, many startups, many companies have started using Kubernetes. And it's a new technology. It's an interesting technology. It's a very good technology. However, there aren't many trained folks to configure Kubernetes. Forget about securing Kubernetes. Now, I wanted to give this as an example. And this is just to highlight that if it can happen to Tesla, it can happen to anyone. So basically, Tesla had kept one of their API servers exposed to the internet without any credentials. So hackers were actually able to get into Tesla's Kubernetes cluster and steal information. Actually, not only steal information, they also used it for crypto mining. Detail about this particular attack is available in the reference section. Again, to highlight that the technology is new, it's very powerful, but there are not enough trained people in this particular domain to secure a Kubernetes cluster properly. There are many defaults by which you can run your Kubernetes cluster. If you're running your Kubernetes cluster on the default, then there are very high chances that your system will get compromised or attacked. So I'm saying Kubernetes is everywhere. If you go to kubernetes.io, this is just a snapshot of the page. But these are some of the companies who are using Kubernetes today. And then there are many more companies, many more startups, universities, colleges that are using Kubernetes. So basically, Kubernetes is everywhere. It is also available on the public internet. So you must have heard about Shodan. Shodan is a search engine to search for specific devices on the internet. Now, this search I had done probably a month or so back. I just searched for Kubernetes, and I did not even use a registered account. Even with this, I could find around 17,000 Kubernetes servers being available publicly. Now, I'm not saying they're exposed, but they are available on the public internet. I have kind of blurred out the IP addresses, but you would see that the IP also of these clusters are available. Now imagine that this is a new technology. People are not not aware of how to configure or how to secure the Kubernetes cluster. For an attacker, they keep on tracking the known vulnerabilities in any software or any project. All they have to do is they have to keep tracking vulnerabilities in Kubernetes. They look at these particular IP addresses available through Shodan or any other means, and then they use the latest exploit available using Metasploit or some other tool to compromise these servers, right? Tesla's server was publicly available in the same fashion. And plus, it was available without any credentials, without any username, password to log in. So with that, it is so easy. Your target is easily available. What attackers need is a target. And your target is easily available if you configure it with a public IP address. You have to sometimes configure it with a public IP address because you need to access the API server to do some configuration remotely or stuff like that. But then it also becomes an easy target for attackers. Now, let's look at an example of an exploit which is easily available, right? So for that, I'll just explain what is RunC first. So RunC is a low-level tool that actually does the task of creating the container. Now, Docker, Containerd, and other such tools actually sit on top of RunC, and they use RunC to actually do the task of creating the container. RANSI is the heart of all these systems, and Kubernetes in turn sits on top of these tools. So Kubernetes will call a Docker, which will actually call a RANSI to actually create a container. Now we've realized that RANSI is at the heart, at the bottom of everything. Now let's look at a CVE. So let me just quickly explain what a CVE is. So if there are vulnerabilities in an open source software or in any proprietary software, those vulnerabilities are tracked worldwide by something called a CVE ID. So if you look here, I'm showing a CVE, CVE-2019-5736. So CVE hyphen the year, it's actually the year in which that vulnerability was discovered. And in that particular year, what is the number of that vulnerability? So this is the 57,036 vulnerability detected in that particular year, a unique number given to a vulnerability. So what is this vulnerability? So the vulnerability goes like this. If a process is running as root inside a container, right, that process can actually exploit a bug in RANSI to gain root privileges on the host on which the container is running. So you have a container running on a host. Now, if this container is running with root privileges, the attacker from this container can exploit RANSI. How does it exploit RANSI? It allows to overwrite the host RANSI binary. Once you have overwritten the RANSI binary, you can overwrite it with whatever binary you want. And then you can get root level access to that particular host. This gives you unlimited access to the server as well as any other containers running on that server. So you can imagine, do you see the problem here? The problem here is that your container was running as root. And since the container was running as root, it became that much more easier for the attacker to get to the host. Now you would say, this is a known vulnerability. People will go ahead, corporates will go ahead and fix it immediately. That's the sad part. Even though vulnerabilities are there, many companies take a long time to actually go and fix those or patch those vulnerabilities. So till that time, those vulnerabilities are available, the attackers, they keep tracking their targets. They keep tracking the clusters or any other target for that reason. And once a vulnerability is known, they will try to exploit that vulnerability in all the known systems. Even before you, fix a date, try to push in the fix, attackers would immediately try to exploit. This is one way in which Kubernetes cluster can be exploited. Even when I started talking about this particular CVE or this vulnerability, people aware about security stuff would know the solution. The solution here is don't run your containers as root. You know, the principle of least privileges. Now, this principle is the same as the principle used for IT security. The same principle applies here also. So that is the thing that I was talking about. The knowledge that I was talking about traditional security is also applicable to Kubernetes security. Now, use spot security policies. So what are security policies? I'm going to cover in subsequent slides. But there are pod security policies like privilege false and allow privilege elevation as false. You can guess from this. So there is something called a security policy. In that, you specify that don't allow privilege pods. So privilege is false and don't allow privilege elevation. Put that also to false. So that is a mitigation for this kind of possible attack. Right. So again, the thing that I want to highlight, and I'm harping a lot on this particular point, but if you would have configured your pod security policy saying privilege pods are not allowed, in that case, even though this vulnerability was discovered and you wouldn't have patched your system, still your system would not be compromised. Okay. So is this the only CVE? No, there are many more CVEs. Another example of CVEs 2018, and these CVEs are coming daily. Now, so it's a moving target. These vulnerabilities are found, they are published on the net. Attackers see these vulnerabilities, they try to attack the system. How do you defend yourself against such moving targets, against zero-day vulnerabilities, about vulnerabilities that you're not aware of? You will take time to patch your system. So what you use is defense in depth. Again, the defense in depth principle is common to traditional security, and it applies beautifully here. And defense in depth means basically you apply security at your application level, you apply at pod level, you apply at node level, you apply at the cluster level, you apply at the master level, you apply the API server level. We'll come to that. But two mantras that even if you don't remember the entire presentation, two things that you should go out of the presentation is, implement the principle of least privileges. Do not let your container run as root unless necessary, and apply defense in depth. How to apply defense in depth is what the presentation is going to cover. Where are the places where you can apply security, and what are the important things in security that you should apply? Again, the presentation is not exhaustive. I don't cover all the security best practices of securing Kubernetes. 30, 40 minutes is very less time. Here, I'm just giving the gist. But if you apply these important principles, then at least your Kubernetes cluster is decently secure. Right? Again, are they specific to Kubernetes environment? No, they are not specific to Kubernetes environment. They are general security principles that apply to traditional software IT security also. Okay, so what is an attack vector? An attack vector is a method or pathway by which an attacker or hacker gains access to the target system. So for example, you want to attack a house, you want to enter into a house. So what is an attack vector in the case of a house? The door is an attack vector, the window is an attack vector, the chimney can be an attack vector. The attacker can try to break the door or try to get a duplicate key of the door or try to, you know, pick the lock and try to get inside. The attacker can try to break the window or try to open the lock of the window or keep the window open, you know, somehow by, you know, keeping a paper so that it doesn't get locked or something. So these are the ways in which a house can be compromised. So these are the different attack vectors in which you can attack a house. So you've got the definition of attack vector, I hope. I'm just trying to explain what an attack vector is. Now, with that in mind, what are the Kubernetes attack vectors? So basically, if you want to attack any software or any application or appliance, you have to see the different ways in which it interacts with users. And 99% of the time, these are the ways in which that particular software or that appliance can be compromised or attacked. So now quick introduction to the architecture of Kubernetes. So you have a master, you have the node. The master has the etcd database, it has a dashboard and the API server. There are many more things in the master, but I'm covering the critical things that can be attacked and should be protected. The node has the application running in it. The application has an image. That image is running on that particular node. That image is running inside a container. And that container is created inside a pod, which has its runtime. And then there's a kubelet that is used to communicate between the node and the master. So all these are possible things that can be attacked in Kubernetes, right? So when you look, if you're creating a checklist of securing your cluster, make sure you have ticked off all these things. Make ssure that your master is secure. And out of turn, probably this is not mentioned in this slide, but you have to physically secure your master and physically secure your host. We are talking about securing the processes inside the master, like etcd, dashboard, API server. We are talking about securing the node, the application or the container inside the node. But make sure that secure the physical access to the master and the physical access to the node, right? If they're physically insecure, so for example, your master is running some SSH service or your master is running some port is open in the master, and then the master can be compromised. So an attacker can bring down the master, can actually bring down services, can actually copy data of etcd even without having to exploit the other vulnerabilities in Kubernetes. So physically protecting the master and physically protecting the node are very important. The attack vectors here are attacking etcd, attacking the dashboard, attacking the API server. So let me go to the next slide. The application code can be compromised, right? The application that is running inside the container. The application, by that I mean, suppose you are using some open source libraries. And those open source libraries have some vulnerability. Like say you're using Bash and Bash has some vulnerability, or you're running a vulnerable version of Bash. That can be compromised and the attacker can use that to get access to the application. You're using some images that you have downloaded from some public repositories. That image might be actually a spiked image. That can, the attacker might have kept a backdoor in that particular image to get access to your Kubernetes cluster. Yes, the point that I was harping on just some time back, the Kubernetes host, the physical host has to be secure. Secure the networking between the host. So when the API server on the master is talking to the kubelet on the slave nodes, that networking has to be protected. You protect the API server, you protect kubelet, you protect etcd, you protect the dashboard. I may not be able to explain all the things that go into securing this, but this should give you an idea that when you create a checklist, when you are trying to say that, hey, my system is secure, make sure that all of this is secure. Okay, that's the point I want to make. Now, protecting the API server. So I've given an example of Tesla before this. Sorry, I keep bringing that up, but don't leave the API server publicly exposed. It's no longer exposed, but sometimes for testing purpose, you might open your API server public access, and then you might forget to close that particular access. So there are a couple of things, flags, which are default now, but make sure those flags are put in place for your API server. Check that those flags are in place. For example, anonymous authentication argument should be set to false. It is disabled by default, but check that your anonymous authentication is disabled. Check that the basic auth file is not set. So basically, if your basic auth file is set, you use plain text credentials for authentication. So make sure that particular file is not set. Enable RBAC. So RBAC is very good. The role-based access control is very good in giving fine-grained control, giving roles and better control over your authentication and access of Kubernetes or Kube API server. So make sure that RBAC is enabled. I'm not covering RBAC in this presentation. But there are many resources available online that can tell you in detail how to configure RBAC and how to protect this server using RBAC. So yes, with the API server out, let's talk about etcd. Again, Shodan. I searched on Shodan for etcd, and I could find around roughly 2,400 etcd servers showing up on it. So what is etcd first? Etcd is a database, a key value pair database that is storing your secrets. So suppose you need to, suppose the container or the pod needs to communicate with the API server. So the information, the passwords, or the security tokens that are used to communicate are stored in etcd. If the system state, the configuration is stored in etcd. So that keeps a snapshot of the system state. So etcd is a very important database. Now imagine that that important database is exposed on the internet. It doesn't need to be on the internet. If there is a specific need, make sure that you have your firewall rules in place. You have, make sure that you're protecting your etcd database. Now, how do you do that? So do not leave your etcd exposed to the internet, right? I've just shown you on Shodan in the previous slide how etcd's databases are exposed on the internet. And encrypt your etcd database at rest and in transit. So how does this help? Now, again, another principle applies, two principles apply. Actually, the defense in depth principle applies here beautifully. If you do the first thing, you're not exposing it to the internet. So one attack vector is gone. Attackers cannot access your database, etcd database, and pull secrets out of it. Having said that, suppose if by mistake it gets exposed to the internet during some upgrade, some wrong configuration got applied and it got exposed and you were not aware of that. And if the attacker got access to your database, if it was encrypted, in that scenario, the attacker, even though has the entire database, the attacker cannot do anything with that meaningful with that information because it is encrypted. So see the beauty here. The defense in depth is applying here. You first made sure that etcd is not exposed to the internet, and encrypting the data is ensuring that the attacker cannot get anything out of that particular information, even if it gets compromised, right? So again, a concept now I'm going to touch. So I've shown you the various attack vectors, the different things that can be attacked in Kubernetes. I've just briefly touched upon how the API server and etcd can be protected. Now let's look at a concept. Concept is user account types in Kubernetes. So there are two types of users in Kubernetes. There are regular users and there are service accounts or service users. So regular users are managed outside of Kubernetes, right? Kubernetes lets you and say these are the users who are actually logging on and starting Kubernetes, installing Kubernetes, stuff like that. Service accounts are tied to every pod. So the pod or the container gets authenticated as a particular service account. A service account is there per pod. If you don't create a service account, that service account gets created automatically, right? So it is also, the service account is also assigned to the main Kubernetes service, right? So every pod has a service account, and that service account is used for authentication to the API server. Now, service accounts are assigned a bearer token, right? That is passed to the API server when making a request. So every service account has a token. That token it passes to the API server whenever it wants to do some communication with the API server. Now, these tokens are stored in the etcd database, the database that I had explained, and the concept about secrets being stored that I touched earlier, right? Now, for pod service accounts, the token are also mounted in the pod's file system. So again, you will see another possible attack scenario that every pod has a password or a secret, and that secret is maintained in the form of a token. That token is also mounted in the pod's file system, right? This is the path where run secrets, right? Where it gets mounted. Now imagine a scenario that an attacker has got access to the container, and if that attacker can do a container escape, the attacker can actually see this token. Using this token, the attacker can start communicating with the API server. And if the API server is not configured properly, or if the container is not or the pod is not configured properly, then the attacker can do much more, right? So just as an example, what we've been discussing so far, the attacker will first compromise the application to get to the pod. Now, using that pod, it can access other services or other containers in their pod. So a container can have, a pod can have multiple containers. You compromised one container, then you can access other containers in that particular pod because they communicate as local host. You can sniff secrets provided by Kubernetes to various pods also, right? So this I'm going to touch upon in detail later. And you can also read the host file system if running is root and with a mount point available. So again, don't run your system as root. And if a mount point is available, then the attacker can actually mount the whole file system. I'm going to touch that in the subsequent slides. So this is another example. I'm just giving you different ways, different examples in which Kubernetes can be compromised. So continuing with the attack theme, anonymous access, this we have already touched actually, but this falls into the category of misconfiguration. So if you are allowing anonymous access, then attackers can connect to your API server and pass on commands. So disable anonymous access, we have already touched upon this. Getting access to the service account, this also we have touched. This is basically the attacker being able to get access to the container and then sniff the token file, right? Reading the token file in which the secret for that particular pod is kept, right? So these are the two ways. So I have explained already misconfiguration and how enabling RBAC or configuring API server properly avoids this or mitigates this particular kind of attack. And getting access to the service account, how it is happening, and to mitigate that particular problem, you have to implement the principle of least privileges, right? Time is short, I'm running fast, but the idea is that there are, I'm explaining a concept and I'm trying to tell you, using this concept, what is a possible attack and how to mitigate it. So when I explain the concept of accounts, how secrets can be sniffed or how it can be compromised and how to mitigate using the principle of least privileges. Remote command execution is another way in which Kubernetes can be attacked. So basically, you are allowed to run a if that particular pod allows you to remotely execute a command on the pod, then an attacker will open a shell onto the pod and then install a backdoor. So if you're allowing remote command executions, then one of the favorite ways of the attacker to compromise is to start bin bash and then install a backdoor on the pod service account token so that the attacker can get access to the system at a later date also. Don't allow remote command executions to your pod unless really critical is a solution to this problem. So this is what we have already covered, but just as a gist, pods can mount the file system volume. Now, if you are allowing access, so one volume type supported is the host path. Basically, if you're allowing the mounting of the host path, and if your pod was created as root, right, then the particular pod or the particular container can mount the root file system. And by mounting the root file system, they can extract SSH keys, authentication tokens, etc. So unless necessary, make sure that the volume type host path is not allowed to be mounted, right? Because imagine that your pod is able to mount the host file system, then the attacker can see everything on that particular node. So this is another way while coming through the container, the attacker can actually manipulate the particular host. Secret access. We have already touched upon secret access. How do you mitigate? Encrypt and keep all your secrets and etcd, and do not allow account access to get secrets or all namespaces. So even though a particular container is compromised, it cannot get the secret or it cannot get secret for all namespaces. So do not allow access to get secrets or all namespace APIs. We have covered this already. Now, this is an important concept. What is an admission controller? So basically, admission controller is a gateway or a code that intercepts requests coming to the API server, right? Now, these controllers can intercept Kubernetes API requests and modify, reject them based on custom logic, the rules that you provide. The beauty of this is that it can control, as per your rules, the access to the API server. There are many admission controllers. There are some 30 admission controllers. I'm going to highlight a couple of important admission controllers. The point, one thing to note is that you have to start the API server with, you have to compile the API server with this admission controller. You can't do it post the API server. So make sure you enable these admission controllers. Point being, there are 30 admission controllers. Look at admission controllers properly. Read them in detail, because admission controllers are like the gateway. They control what kind of request can actually go to the API server. Now let's look at an admission controller of pod security policies. It is an optional admission controller. So this pod security policy admission controller is a cluster level resource, right? Basically, any rule that you specify using this security policy gets applied to the entire cluster or all the containers that are getting spawned on that particular cluster. The pod security policy objective defines a set of conditions that a pod must run with in order to be accepted into the system. So basically, when a pod is getting created, these policies are looked at, and the pod will only be created if it adheres to these policies, right? Now, so let's look at an example of a pod security policy. So if you look at this, this configuration, the kind is specifying a pod security policy. And in specs, you're specifying privilege is false. So this is the same thing that I had shown initially, the first CV, that if you would have put privilege as false and privilege elevation as false, this is where you specify that. So if you enable pod security policy, and if you apply this rule, then no privilege pods will be created on a particular cluster. It's a cluster-wide policy that gets applied. But that's the beauty. If you apply this rule, then and if your cluster is used by multiple users, you don't have to worry that some user might mistakenly, inadvertently create a privileged pod. This will ensure that nobody is able to create a privileged pod on the system, right? This is something important. Other than that, there are network policies also. But first, for explain network policies, I have to explain the service mesh. So, right. So you have these pods, you have these containers, they want to communicate with each other. How do you ensure that the communication happens securely? Imagine in a Kubernetes cluster, there are many containers running. And some container is actually, some container is actually malicious containers trying to sniff the traffic that is going on between these containers. So you have to secure the traffic, encrypt the traffic that is going on between these containers. So that's when the process, when the concept of service mesh comes in. And Istio is a type of service mesh. So what is a service mesh? It is all about networking of microservices and the interaction between them to control or to secure the communication between microservices. You use a service mesh. Istio is a Google open source project, and it provides service to service authentication, right? It provides a load balancing, monitoring, and identity based authentication authorization, right? So just to explain in brief what Istio does, Istio actually installs a proxy in each pod. It installs a piece of code in each pod, and then it gets dynamically reconfigured by the Istio control plane. So you push a rule in Istio, that rule gets pushed into that particular proxy that is installed in each pod. The beauty of using this is that you don't have to, so suppose you want to do a pod-to-pod secure communication. You don't have to modify your code, you don't have to modify your logic. Just install Istio. Istio will install proxies into these particular pods, and those proxies will apply the rules that you provide to Istio. No change in your code or your application is required. So this is the diagram that explains it. It uses a sidecar concept. Basically, if you see service A has a proxy installed in it, similarly, service B has another proxy involved in it, and the control plane then pushes rules into these proxies. The Citadel, for example, has certificates. So each service would have a certificate configured for it, and then they do secure communication using the certificates. So enable service mesh for secure communication between your pods in the cluster, right? This is another advice that I would give you, other than the things that we have covered so far. How does it provide security? It gives security by default. It gives defense in depth, zero trust networking, right? The most important for me is that it provides strong mutual authentication using TLS, right? So mutual authentication between the services, you know who you're talking to, and then it automatically gets encrypted. Management of keys and certificate rotation is also managed by Istio. That's another beautiful part of Istio. So look at service mesh, secure that communication between your containers and your pods is another thing that I would do. Network policies. Now you have Istio, you have service mesh. Why do you need network policies? So service mesh, this applies at layer 7, but network policies apply at layer 3 and 4. So basically, all pods in a cluster are non-isolated by default, right? They can access each other. If you apply network policies to a pod, the pod will reject all connections that are not allowed by the network policy. So suppose you have a backend server and you have your frontend web server. So the backend server should be only accessible by the frontend network server. You want to configure that firewall rule that is configured using network policies. So network policies will let you define rules as to which pod can be accessed by which other pod, right? Both go hand in hand, the network policies as well as the service mesh. Using these two together gives you defense in depth and better security for Kubernetes cluster, right? Just continuing with the slide, the network policy is just as an API resource that defines a set of rules for pod access, right? However, to enable the network policies, we need plugins like Kalio, Kellenium, etc. Right? So these are, I'm probably not pronouncing that properly, but these are network plugins that are actually used to enable network policies, right? Again, network policies are at layer 3 and 4, service meshes are at layer 7. Both are aware of Kubernetes labels, right? to describe pod endpoints. Use both of them together to secure your Kubernetes cluster better. Which brings us to secure design principles. This is the summary of the presentation. All the security design principles that we've spoken about, let's summarize here. Don't run anything as root unless necessary. Apply the principle of least privilege. Use admission controller in Kubernetes. Admission controller, RBAC, this will ensure that API server etcd is not accessed by people who don't need to access it. Use minimum number of packages required for application. Because what happens is over a period of time, you lose track of those packages and they will get outdated and will provide an attack vector for an attacker or hacker to get into your system. Scan container images regularly for known vulnerabilities, right? So if you keep scanning, you will come to know that if there is some open source package or there is some malware that has been embedded into your container image, have a regular cadence of, say, scanning monthly or weekly, whatever suits you, but make sure that you scan the container images regularly. Protect the pod using pod security policies. Protect the networking between the Kubernetes host. We have looked at service mesh, right? Secure the Kubernetes host itself. Harden the system, right? Switch off unnecessary ports. Don't install packages which are not required on that particular host. This is, I'm talking about the master and the worker nodes. Again, very important thing is to maintain good auditing and logging, right? This will ensure that if there is some suspicious activity happening, it stands out. This principle again is common to Kubernetes as well as general network security or application security. Audit your system regularly and maintain a good logging, and along with logging, actually analyze the logs, right? Ensure that API server and kubelet use mutual authentication. So the kubelet is the service running in the node, and it is interacting with the API server. So make sure that it is using mutual authentication. Kubelet service rotation, certificate rotation has to be done. So ensure you're doing that certificate rotation. Don't expose your dashboard to the public internet. Again, the same principle that applied to etcd or the API server, right? Not enough time to cover securing Kubernetes in the cloud, but if you see all of them, if you use any of this, say for example, use a Google Kubernetes engine, GKE, they will make sure that all these principles that you have learned or heard about this year are implemented by the GKE, or the Google Kubernetes engine. Along with that, they provide their own set of tools and services. Make sure that they're enabled when you configure in their environment. There are some good tools that I want to mention in the end. There is something called a Kubebench. So there is a CIS Kubernetes benchmark that basically a checklist of what should be done to secure a Kubernetes cluster. Kubebench actually runs on your deployed Kubernetes cluster and checks whether your system meets those benchmarks. Free tool. I definitely recommend using this. KubeHunter is again a tool that is used to look for security weaknesses in your Kubernetes cluster. Kalio, that I've already touched for network policies and network security. References, these are things that you can look up. In the end, you'll see the Tesla hack example that I had mentioned about, right? So, yes. So again, just to summarize, there is lots in the topic. Understanding the I have just given you a glimpse into the different ways in which your system or cluster can be compromised. There would be many more ways. There would be many other ways in the, which the attackers can compromise your system. But one thing that we can take away from this presentation is understand all the possible ways in which you can secure Kubernetes or etcd or other components in your cluster and enable all of them, defense in depth. So even if an attacker is able to come through one gate, there is the attacker, he or she will find the other gate block, right? So that's it. Thank you very much for attending my presentation. I hope you found this presentation useful, and I hope it helps you in securing your Kubernetes cluster. So thank you very much.